functional anatomy of the rotator cuff, structure, biomechanics, and clinical relevance. Introduction to the rotator cuff. The rotator cuff is a group of four muscles, the subscapularis, supraspinatus, infraspinatus, and teres minor, that form a cuff around the glenohumeral joint. Each contributes uniquely to shoulder mechanics and joint stability. Structural overview. Subscapularis. The subscapularis, the largest and most powerful rotator cuff muscle, arises from the anterior scapula and inserts on the lesser tuberosity. It functions as an internal rotator and stabilizer, especially in the position of abduction and external rotation. Supraspinatus. The supraspinatus originates from the supraspinous fossa and inserts on the superior facet of the greater tuberosity. It is crucial for initiating abduction and maintaining glenohumeral congruency. Infraspinatus. The infraspinatus arises from the infraspinous fossa, inserting into the middle facet of the greater tuberosity. It is the primary external rotator and posterior stabilizer. Teres minor. The teres minor, a narrow muscle below the infraspinatus, inserts into the inferior facet and complements external rotation and posterior stability. Tendon fusion and functional integration. Near their humeral insertions, the tendons of the supraspinatus and infraspinatus merge into a common structure. The integrity of this fusion is critical for coordinated movement and force transmission. The rotator cable and crescent. The rotator cable acts like a suspension bridge, transferring loads across the cuff and shielding the thinner, avascular crescent zone. Tears in the crescent may be tolerated biomechanically, while cable disruption often leads to significant dysfunction. Biomechanics of force couples. Functional stability arises from balanced force couples. Coronal plane, the deltoid and supraspinatus act synergistically during abduction. Transverse plane, the subscapularis and infraspinatus counterbalance each other to prevent humeral head translation. Overhead movements, especially when loaded and repetitive, increase the risk of impingement and injury. Strengthening the rotator cuff muscles is important, however, exercises must be biomechanically sound. Future videos will demonstrate these recommended exercises. Clinical correlation and tear patterns. Tears are classified into crescent-shaped and U-shaped configurations. Crescent tears are often reparable with minimal tension. U-shaped tears typically require margin convergence due to medial extension. The location of the tear, especially involvement of the cable or subscapularis, significantly affects function. Common causes of rotator cuff or biceps long head injuries include overuse, trauma, degeneration with aging, or overhead activities. Long head of the biceps and pulley system. The long head of the biceps tendon, anchored at the supraglenoid tubercle or labrum, plays a stabilizing role. The pulley system, formed by the coracohumeral and superior glenohumeral ligaments, protects against anterior instability. Summary and surgical implications. Understanding the rotator cuff's anatomy, including insertion patterns and biomechanical roles, is crucial for diagnosing pathology, planning surgical repairs, and preserving shoulder function. Acromion morphology, for example, hooked versus flat, can increase impingement risk. Shoulder pain may arise from either rotator cuff or biceps pathology. Clinical examination and imaging, such as MRI, are necessary for accurate diagnosis. Based on clinical experience, a significant proportion of shoulder pain cases are due to biceps-related pathology. Therefore, doctor's examination and diagnosis is very important. Thank you for watching. For more detailed discussions on shoulder biomechanics, subscribe and follow. In upcoming videos, we'll demonstrate how to strengthen the rotator cuff safely with sound biomechanical principles. A link to the related exercise video will be provided.